We're live. Good day, guys. Nathaniel Evans, you know, owner of the podcast, I'm a Data. This podcast focuses on leadership and redemption, right? And today I have with me Jana Muhammad, your global happiness expert, right? And today we have an interesting topic for our audience, all those that tune in, all those that catch us later on and download. We were actually focusing on leadership today. So the topic today is, where is your gratitude in leadership? Yes. You know, me and Miss Muhammad Jean, we're going to call her Jean, we spoke about leadership from our last podcast. And we spoke about it. We was like, we got to do another podcast because, you know, this is a really, you know, really deep concept, right? And, you know, it's going to take more than one podcast. So this is actually going to turn out to be a series on actually dealing with this topic right here. And, you know, you're going to see a lot of us, you know, in the coming days, in the coming weeks. And we're looking at leadership and why is leadership, you know, so important, you know, in this day and time, and how will leadership, you know, define, you know, who we are as a people, you know, going forward. Right. So with that, I just want Gina to come in real quick. Say a couple of words, you know, to our people. And then from there, we're just actually going to get to the nitty gritty and actually show people what's here and why we actually focus on this topic in the first place.
Peace and blessings, beautiful souls. I am Jeannie Muhammad, your global happiness expert. I strive to aid and empower people that have faced challenges in their lives, have lost that happiness and that joy and that peace. And so my mission is to be a guide. I'm only a guide, leading us back to that power. That's correct. Power that we have within. Ooh, and so I am happy to be here. And as Nathaniel said, we have so much to share. So let's just do that deep dive.
Move forward. It's a topic right here, you know, that really strikes close to my heart because I've been moving in so many different leadership platforms throughout the years and, you know, nonprofits, you know, prison systems, being a leader in those structures, working on different campaigns to save lives like Close Rikers Island or protect homelessness in the land. These are movements to save lives. You know, it's not to really propel, you know, individuals to be in leadership positions, even though it translates into that. It's actually about saving the lives that you don't know and that will know who you are once you save their lives.
Right.
And gratitude of actually even being in those positions, be able to make those changes, be able to indoctrinate different laws or, you know, manifest different laws are the essential tools that we need to preserve life.
Yes.
You know, and this is not what I would say, we're going to touch on later on. This is not an individual conquest. We have been looking at leadership in this land, and leadership in this land is biased. Let me say this again. The leadership in this land is biased. They focus on one individual to bring forth leadership. That is not leadership. No. They've been depicting these weird stories for centuries about this one man that came through. He was flying on the top of an eagle and he slayed all the beasts. They've been using these terminologies for a long time.
make it plain, Nathaniel.
I make it plain, but I'm just saying, like, you know, it's just a heroic thing how they operate the leaders. And put them on this weird plateau, put them on this weird concept and this weird plateau that when this leader falls short within himself, he's lost or she's lost.
That's right.
These are one of the reasons why that concept of one man as a leader, one woman as a leader, has to be modified.
Yes.
Because,
I totally agree with you because what I thought when you were saying that is how so many times we abdicate our leadership the leadership that we have as individuals and understanding that we are all leaders.
That's right. That's correct. That's correct. Yeah, so when we go into, if I work for a nonprofit, then they gave me this little title, this little badge, then they say, listen, man, your responsibility to go out there and build communities up, bring communities back into the agency so they can know that we out here for them and that they're not staying alone. Any person that's in the agency that goes with me into a different environment, they are also deemed as leaders stamped by the organization. So you're moving in your leadership according to the organizational purpose and not your purpose.
Right.
Right? So when you go here, all of a sudden you have all this power, you have all this because you got decision-making tools, you got resources at your disposal. You say you have a team that's behind you. So when you go into these spaces, you're expected to do the work of the organization according to their leadership. That's, a lot of times your leadership is not involved in that process.
Yes. Yes. And I want to say this because I have a story in my life that it is exactly what you're saying. I worked for, and I'm not going to name the organization, but it's a big cable conglomerate. And I started off in a you know, entry-level position. But, you know, I was moved up fast because that's what a lot of organizations do. They will see in you the leadership capacities that you have, and they'll figure out a way to use it for their benefit.
I wouldn't mean the word use is a great word, but I would use the word harness.
Okay, okay. I'll go along with that.
They will harness your energy. They will harness your purpose, and they will take it for themselves.
Yes.
You got nothing to do with it.
Yes. And most of us are so starved for recognition, so starved to have those titles, and we just think this is great that all at once I'm being called a manager, I'm being called a director, I'm being called, you know, these titles. And sometimes the money compensation don't even equal out to the responsibilities that you have to handle, but you have these talents.
That title keeps you locked into a space that makes you believe that you are all important.
Yes.
That, you know, your purpose is actually has been aligned to this organization, to this structure, to this movement, to the point when once you adapt your purpose to those places are able to have their way with you.
Yes. And this is where that, to me, selling your soul to the devil, you sell your soul to the devil for a piece of silver, and the next thing you know, you are saying and doing things that do not align with your true values, but because you're in this position, in this company, then you start to do things that do not align with your values. And my story is this. I was given this position, a manager, my own office, you know, my name on the door, all this wonderful things. But I realized that a lot of the policies that I was asked to implement, I did not agree with.
That's right.
But I'm doing it. It has my name behind it.
Right.
But I didn't agree with it.
Didn't agree with it, but you still took on that responsibility because you was obligated to do so. Once you walk into the position, once you sign these different contracts, all of a sudden you're obligated. I was in a place one time, and I'm, you know, we're not going to name organizations. We won't put people under the bus. But I was in an organization at one time, and I was responsible for a database system for HIV and AIDS. And, you know, I'm like, okay, well, I had just came out of prison. I had just actually just did 11 and a half years in prison. I'm in this organization within 6 months. I done got like five or six different tasks. attached to me. And I remember that, you know, I had this director, you know, that she would go behind my back and basically doctor the paperwork. She would actually change negatives into positives so they can actually start receiving money. And I would never say nothing to her. Mm-hmm. You know, I would actually go to the IT person and say, yo, you have to remove this, and remove that. And he moved it because I was over the database system. It was my mm-hmm. responsibility. Mm-hmm. And I remember she came to me and was like, yo, she was like, yo, try to bring some people in. So she was basically like, I thought, you know, you actually take one for the team. You know, and I was like, well, you know, the last thing I want to do is go to the feds for doctoring books. I just got out the state. You know, I'm not trying to graduate. Like, I'm just trying to, you know, I don't need no more prizes. I don't need no more gifts, right? So I'm not going to do this, right? And, you know, and it was really profound to see how, you know, people was coming against my leadership. And not allow me to blossom according to the energy that I brought into the organization, but wanted to craft me according to their concepts and their beliefs and values, to the point when I walk out the organization, I have no more substance.
Right.
I have no more integrity. I have no more purpose because I gave it away for a couple of dollars.
Right.
I gave it away so I can be at peace with making money so I can pay for rent, light bill, gas bill, sneakers and hats. Right.
Right. And this really brings us into our subject about the gift of gratitude. See, mm. when you are grateful for what God has given you, you are grateful for the talents and the gifts that he has given you, you decide that you're not going to sell them for cheap. Mm. You know, you're not going to give them away cheaply, sell your soul for a piece of silver, because you are grateful mm-hmm. to, and you are just grateful for what God has given you, and you're not That's going great. To just give it away for a cheap price.
For a cheap price. And that actually brings me to my first question, is that do leaders extend gratitude basically like water? Do they actually just extend gratitude? Is it an easy thing for leaders to say, here go the gifts that I have received because of you or because of them?
Do I think that it's easy? Not for a lot of leaders. I don't think it's easy, because a lot of times we don't really do what I call that deep down examination, reflection, to see who we truly are as leaders, and where are we leading the people that we are in charge of? Where are we leading them? What are we leading them to? So if we don't know ourselves as leaders, and we don't know what our purpose is as a leader, then how can we really lead someone or truly be grateful for where we are and lead someone else into that same mindset?
That's correct. I agree with that. I agree that if you don't understand the purpose of a leadership tool that you have developed, you would do more damage in that space than you actually do good. Regardless if you come out on top and you actually have these resources and these tools, it doesn't change the fact that other leaders that was in your midst are no longer there.
That's right. Right?
That's like going into your garden and planting some roses, and then, you know, you go over here and you plant some pear trees, and you plant these type of trees or whatever, and when you go back, they all gone. Mm. There's nothing else there. Wow. It's just straight barren. It's just like, I didn't plant nothing, right? Ooh. I don't have that comfort. When I go into my garden, I can just sit in my garden, if it's completed, and just meditate, you know, just get in tune,
right.
You see what I'm saying, with what I have brought forth, what I have planted, what I have brought right. into my life, right? So if I go back and there's nothing there,
wow.
It's like, what's going on? Like, didn't I just put these seeds in here? Didn't I actually water this? Wasn't I out here pulling weeds the other day?
Wow.
So Why is it not there for me anymore? What's going on? Right?
Right.
This sister says here, she said, Ms. Denise Coates, I'm saying no foundation.
That's right. Oh, that is so beautiful. That is really actually the problem. When we don't have a firm foundation, when what we are building is like built on quicksand, where there is nothing to hold it up, then it doesn't take much for a wind to come along and blow it apart, because it's not on a firm foundation. And sometimes if we have built a firm foundation, the wind may blow the building away and the foundation will still be standing. So we still have something to rebuild on.
That's correct. You know, and she's, you know, she's speaking again, Ms. Denise, she's involved today. That's great. You know, she's saying that it's hollow. You know, it's like you will get that gold chain, but it ain't nothing inside. You know what I'm saying? You just tap on it, hear the echo, right? And it's like the leadership is like an echo, right? When people come into the space that this is one leader, they knock on this leader, and they can hear this leader whole vibration.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They hear this one leader whole story, because they don't got a structure. He's not solid. She's not solid from within. You know what I'm saying? And then they look across the room and say, well, there's 20 people over here. Why didn't he bring them 20 people over here to stand with him? You know what I'm saying? So no one can determine what is his true essence.
Right.
What does he really stand on? Right. Why would he allow himself to be hollow? Why would he allow people to see that he just stand by himself, or she just stand by herself? Why would they allow people to do that? Right. You would let anybody come into your garden and just start plucking things out of your garden?
That's
without your
permission? That's right.
Would you do that? If you're not going to do that on a physiological aspect, why would you do it on a metaphysical one?
That's right.
Why would you let somebody come in metaphysically and pluck up your garden that you planted, or that the Most High brought you to plant, if you believe in those things or not, right? But you're not here just by a coincidence. You're here for a purpose.
Right. And that's where that self-reflection and that deep down, you'll hear me talk about this all the time, because so many of us go through life that we are just not living, but we're existing, because we do not do that deep down self-examination to see who we truly are, the gifts that God has given us, and work though, because that's our garden.
That's right. That's our garden. When we move on a movement and others come into our space, regardless of what form they come in, regardless of how they come to you, it's like Christ said, come as you are, right? Don't go home and put makeup on, you know what I'm saying? Put on your best pair of shoes, you know what I'm saying? Gather your greatest shirt, right? That's not who you are, right? You're only using those things as a substance. Right. They have nothing to do with you. Right. You didn't create those shoes. You didn't create that hat. Yes. You didn't create those scarves. You didn't create those cars. You didn't create those houses. Those things have nothing to do with you.
That's
right. It comes to the point where you need to know what your purpose is. And we spoke about it in our last podcast. Your purpose is you, the inner man, the inner woman, that peace. That's what moves you forward. That what increases you in the land. When you start focusing on these other things, or they're not going to accept me because, you know, this, or they're not going to accept me because of that, you can't get into those things, because you're not here for the acceptance of other people.
Right. And we start selling out. We start selling out as leaders because we want those things, and this world will offer you those things the same way. See, I love it how you understand the Bible so much, Nathaniel. And I look at how Christ was Jesus was on this mountain, and the devil came to him and spread out all of this before him and said that you can have all of this, just follow me. But see, what Jesus realized, he already had all of that.
He had everything he needed.
He had, right? Yes.
That's right. And it also shows, you know, you could read the Bible 1,000 times and come across that passage and never really see the significance of what he was trying to say.
Yes.
You would think that if a man falls, that he's infallible, right? But you don't realize that the man probably wasn't able to withhold or withstand that test. So he has to come back. She has to come back. You know what I mean? You need to understand what that is. If Christ was able to be tempted on a high level, what makes you think that you're not going to be tempted on a high level?
That's right.
Right. What makes you think that you're not going to basically, you're not going to fall, you're not going to succumb to certain things? It doesn't define you. Everything that we're going through as leaders, they should not define who you are. They should give you a purpose and a substance to stand on and recreate who you are, recreate that will. Go into introspection. Go into the mountaintop where nobody's around and just scream for a whole hour so you can pull those things out of your way. Right?
Yes.
You are not dictated by any of these things that you come across or anything that came against you. It is not your defining moment. It is not your truth.
Yes, yes. I love Denise.
It begins with you. And then this is another one right here. She hit, you know, she's going for the gut with this one, you know.
Oh, yes.
You're dark on the inside. That's why your light can't shine. And I agree with that to a certain extent, because you can go into a space with so much light, and leaders can take that light and turn it into a darkness against you. Right?
Oh, yes. That is so true.
And then they step out of your way and say, I had nothing to do with your fall.
Oh, Nathaniel. In the Holy Quran, there is a passage that the devil says to people, I only called you and you came. So don't blame me. Don't blame me for where you are. I just called you.
See? You see? And this is how it goes back to you, right? Even though there's been other things that have been in the midst of it, others would not take responsibility. They would say it's solely on you.
I just offered it, right?
No, you have to be able to see, like we said, why you're in the room, who's in the room, and what are they cultivating? What are they planting? What seeds are they bringing into this space? Right?
Nice.
Because a gardener get tired, right? A gardener sometimes say, "Yo, I don't want to garden today, man. You know, I'm exhausted."
Yes.
Right? They get tired, but they still might go and do it. But when you see them tired, you say, oh, they tired, they wore down. You know, I don't see the right energy in them. No, we all go through different processes. We all go through our different changes. And I believe in a time like this, with the world so suffocating, it suffocates leaders. It suffocates people that come onto platforms and try to bring about changes. And those that's around that leader or around those leaders should understand that they're in a pressure cooker. Not just you as a leader, but those that are behind you is in a pressure cooker. So Christ was showing you, he was on a mountaintop. If they're coming at me, imagine what they're trying to do to my disciples.
Okay, and that is why, as a leader, it is so important that we cultivate the people that we are leading so that they're standing on their own power. They're standing.
Oh, you hear? You hit it on the nose. You hit it right on the nose, right? You have to be able to stand your own power, like that rose that basically came out the earth. When you see that rose, now you can smell it, you can touch it, you can look at the firmness of it, you can see the beauty of it. It's bright, bright red.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It's standing its own power until you pluck it up and then you give it to somebody as a gift, and the next thing you know, in 3 days, it's dead. Right?
Oh, wow. Yes.
Right, so at the end of the day, you got to realize that any being that comes into your path, you know what I'm saying, is a part of your garden. You can't plant your garden. The Most High plants your garden. The universe plants your garden. Which my next question is, does the universe like gifts?
I do. I believe that the universe loves gifts.
Ooh. Yeah, like, you know, like, you expect the universe to just keep giving you all these gifts, keep cultivating you, man, giving you full body massages, you know what I'm saying, carrying you when you no longer carry yourself. But when you come into different entities that the universe has also done these things for, and the universe has also brought into your path, because you might be on a higher plateau, you might have a deeper insight, you know what I'm saying, within you, right? You would say that I don't got to go back and water this garden. I don't got to go back and give out the gifts that the universe has given me, because these gifts belong to me. These are my gifts, right? And now you do the universe, not the person, but the universe, a disservice, because the universe is saying, wow, I thought this person was worthy of getting these gifts and bestowing it to others.
And see, you know, I always say, you know, I say God, you say higher power. Somebody else may say the universe. Someone else may, but you know, it those are words, because they are all the same. The universe, God, all of it is the same. And in the Holy Quran, it says that God hates ingratitude.
That's a strong word. Say that again.
The universe hates ingratitude.
That's correct.
The higher power hates ingratitude.
Yeah, there's a story in the Bible, man, right? It's amazing, man. It was this guy, this guy owed this other guy money. So the guy ran him down and was like, yo, man, you know, matter of fact, it was the other way. The guy owed the king some money. Okay. So the king was coming through the land, and he ran into the king, and he basically was like, yo, please forgive me. Please forgive me. You know, I don't have the money. Can you please forgive me for my debt? I don't have the money. And the king was like, you know what? I don't really need the money like that. You came to me in a humble spirit, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, your debt is forgiven, mm-hmm. right? So now the guy ran off. He thanked the king. He ran off, you know, and the king just kept walking through the land. And then a few minutes later, he saw the same guy beating another man because the man owed him money.
Oh.
And the king told his soldiers, apprehend that man. Bring that man to me. He said, didn't I just forgive you for your debt? He said, yes. He said, why would you beat another man for his debt if I just forgive you for your debt? Why don't you just forgive him for his debt as well? He said, not only do you owe me double, and I'll put you in a dungeon.
Ooh. That is deep.
That is deep. And this is coming straight out of scripture. So you call yourself whatever you want to call yourself, and you're coming from scriptures. This is in the scriptures. In itself, it has not been wiped away. It is there. It's a solid entity for our lives and for us to actually go back for encouragement and for awareness.
And you know, so many times what we do, Nathaniel, we read the Holy Quran, we read the Holy Bible, and we put it back thousands of years ago, and we don't bring it up to present time and apply it to our lives. We want to look at it as something that happened thousands of years ago. But the only way we can bring these scriptures to life is to implement them into our lives and today. And that's what I love, the way you bring it into what we are dealing with today.
Because that's the only reason why it would be presented to us, because it's in the here and now. Why would some people present it to us before we was even born? For us to actually come to us and attract us and to basically instill energy and instill life in us, if it has no truth, if it has no bearing, if it has no purpose. Even if you go into a bookstore and pick a book up, why did you pick that book up? It has a purpose. That man that wrote that book might be dead. That woman that wrote that book might be dead.
Right?
They might not be living those principles no more that they wrote in that book, but they wrote those things in the book for you. You came across this information. You came across this knowledge. So now you're able to increase yourself. I'm saying, according to the information that's available to you at that particular time and that date, that moment, that stamp. There is no other moment but that moment right there that you're in. You're waiting for an ultimate moment. You're waiting for a spectacular time to come. It's not going to come. There is no utopia. You are the utopia.
That's right. We can have it now.
This
now.
Is us. Yeah, we're here now. We're in the moment. We're not here yesterday. We're not here in the future. We're here right now at this particular time. right, to learn from the examples of our ancestors. So, for instance, if I go to a family gathering and they have an album book and they say, this is your aunt from 1870, and I say, my aunt from 1870 is dead, and rip the picture up, what's going to happen to me? I'm not going to get out of that house. You're not gonna let me out the house, man. Like, I'm about to jump out the window to get out of there, man. They're not gonna play with me, man. They're not gonna play with me. You know, they're like, yo, what is this? What's going on? What is this guy doing?
Right.
You know, and I'm going to get hurt as a result, you know, of that. Even I'm gonna lose friendships, family members, and all type of stuff. By that one act, but my aunt is actually not here. But no. Is she? Is she not here? She actually might be here. She's here in spirit.
Yes. Right?
We remember her. She's here through us because without her, we wouldn't be here. We have no lineage.
Right.
We have no history. Not many people come into this land and live up an inheritance. They don't make no money. They don't got no aspirations. They get inheritance for $100 million, $50 million. 10 million. And I didn't able to live a life, I'm saying, that they were never thought of or phantom because the person that came before them.
And you know, that is so profound to think about, because I think about my father, and I always talk about how abusive my father was to my mother, and he was truly an abusive man. Mm-hmm. But I don't know what caused him to, you know, have that type of psyche, that he was mm-hmm. that way towards my mother. But on the other hand, my father gave me so much, because my father never had the attitude that there was not anything that he could not do. Mm. He always had that I can attitude.
That's right.
He instilled that in me. And that's a gift. Yes.
And that's a gift. You can't replace that gift, you know, regardless of what happened in your inner circle or outer circle, that's still a gift. And you're going to actually live that gift on. And unknowingly, you're going to pass that gift on to others as well.
Yes.
See, that's the whole point of any gift, is to be able to pass it on. And gifts, you know, they're not meant for people that don't need them.
Right. Right.
People like to give gifts to people that don't need the gift.
Oh, say that again. People and like sometimes the people
that don't need the gift. They will bypass the person that needs the gift, the gift to give to somebody else, because they in turn want to be gifted back.
Yes. Yes. And remember what I said about what my father would say? He would always say, whenever you do a kindness for someone, do not expect payment. Because if you expect payment for, say, fixing a flat for someone, you have not done a kindness. They have just hired you as a flat fixer.
That's right. That's right. That's correct. That's right. You know, my next question is, what is the state of leadership today? Is it about money, purpose, or substance?
Ooh, unfortunately, most leadership is about the money. And that is why we're in the condition that we're in, I do believe. Because most people, when they, or a lot of people, when they reach a leadership position, they let the money that is, and we're so easily bought. And because the money becomes so important that we forget about having any values, passing on any value. All we are looking at is, how am I going to appease the person that is providing the money so that I can keep getting. And the more we get.
Yeah, so if you basically provided me money without purpose and substance, that means that I'm also without purpose and substance.
That's right. That's right. Right?
See, I gotta realize why I have taken this money from you, this gift from you, and what does it take for me as a leader?
Right.
How am I able to have purpose and substance as a leader after I take this structure?
Yes.
After I take this newfound position, because you actually, what you did was, you said, listen, you're not on your path. Right. I'm going to put you on your path.
Right. That's true.
That's basically what you're saying to me, that I'm not on my path, that you have my path laid out for me. And it's impossible that you actually have my path laid out for me when my path brought me to the space that you occupy. It didn't bring me to you. It brought me into that space.
Right, right. And Nathaniel, if you are, and we call ourselves a leader, but we do not understand who we are and what our purpose is, but are we truly leaders? Or are we puppets?
Right.
Are we the puppet for someone else? And because we are a puppet for someone, the one that has the money, the one that is providing the money, and we have sold our souls for that money. Now we have people. Said. Yes. Yes. Stay true to yourself. Don't sell your soul. And once you stay true to yourself, then you can truly develop.
You can truly develop your soul.
Yes.
You can get in tune with your soul because you was able to withstand tests of the times. You was able to withstand the infallible nature of man. You know, when you go to uproot something and they say you're not supposed to uproot this, it is them that's supposed to be uprooted. It is not you. You do not turn back, I'm saying, from your purpose, from your passion, like Denise said, you know what I'm saying, to go into a space that will never cultivate you.
Right, right.
You were born here by cultivation.
Yes, and I want to say right now, this is a good place for me to offer my gift. I want to offer a gift to everyone. It's the title of I am developing an e-course based on gratitude. And the first ebook in the course is a full ebook. It's 10 chapters all about gratitude and developing gratitude. And I want to offer it to our audience free. No strings attached. I'm not trying to buy your soul.
It's actually free. It's actually free.
It's actually free. Same. Nothing attached. But yeah.
So what code are you using? The code they can use when they go into your inbox or they reach out to you, that you will know that they is part of this segment, part of our discussion to actually receive
the gift of gratitude. Just say the gift of gratitude.
Let's say the gift of gratitude. Right?
Yes.
And we're going to put that in there now. And what happened? No, this is wrong. Okay, there you go.
And I will give you how you can contact me. You can, my email is jeannie@imjeanniem.com. That's jeannie@imjeanniem.com. And I will, you know, I'll put it in a PDF form and just send it to you. And it gives us a lot of ways that we can build our gratitude muscle. See, gratitude is like a muscle, you know.
Break that down.
Yes. You know how when we go into the gym and we want to, increase the muscles in our arms. There are maybe certain machines in that gym that they say work out on these number of times, these number of days. And once you do that, you're going to be able to look at that muscle in your arm and it's going to be bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger because you are working towards building up that muscle. It's the same with gratitude. We have to, if we don't have it now in our lives, we can start out developing it by practices, certain practices that we can go through on a daily basis to build up our gratitude to the point where, you know, it just comes natural.
Yeah, just a natural process. You know, actually bring me to the next question is leadership a gift to those that find it?
Yes, I would say it is a gift. But yeah, but the key word is find it.
Find it, right? You found it, right? You went and searched for your own leadership, right? Yes, you know, your inner man, you worked on him, you did whatever you had to do to tap into your inner man, and it brought you to your gifts. You found your gift in a land. No one, and I mean no one, should be able to step in front of your gifts. You know what I'm saying? Let no one evaluate you. Let no one put you in a nice little box of convenience. You know what I'm saying? Let no egotistical thing that's in this land come against you and your gift. It is your gift. It doesn't belong to anything or anybody.
Yes. And that is that foundation that Denise was talking about earlier. And it goes into what I always say during that self-examination, self-reflection, understanding who we are, where we are, and understanding all the gifts that we have been given. And developing those gifts and knowing that these are our gifts.
Yeah, that's the key, knowing that these are our gifts. I don't have to explain anything to you. When I come into this space, I'm here. If you don't want to accept my gifts and me coming to the spirit and me coming into this space, then that's your loss. Because I actually came here to give out a gift that can basically sharpen the gift of you. If you do not think that my gifts are able to sharpen you, then there is an issue here in this whole movement. Regardless of what the movement is, we can be selling t-shirts. If you don't think I got a gift of gab and selling t-shirts, there was no reason for you to bring me into this space, right? You know, keep it as simple as possible, right?
Ooh. My husband will tell you, that's my keep it simple.
Simple. Yeah, keep it simple, man. Don't be messing around with this. I was even in prison and they had, you know, me teaching these phase one and phase two classes. And they was like, keep it simple, stupid. Right? This was the concept that they was using. Right? At the end of the day, you need to know, like, you know, Denise said that iron sharpens iron.
Iron.
Right? Yeah, this is what it does, man. Iron does not sharpen wood. Iron will cut right through wood. It will cut through plastic. It will cut through vinyl. It will cut through anything that you wanted to cut through other than another piece of iron. You know what I'm saying? Don't look at me as a piece of wood and look at yourself as an iron when you and I is in the same space. You are not an iron against me. We are both here for the same purpose. You know what I'm saying? Maybe your approach might be different than mine. Maybe your energy might be different than mine's. Maybe I have to grow a little bit more as a leader. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, understand this. I came here to sharpen you. Are you here to sharpen me?
Yes. Yes. Are we always looking at what someone else can give us rather than how can I contribute to this person's life and elevate in some way? This person, because this society pits us against each other.
It moves us in a space where we're unfamiliar spaces, you know, unfamiliar spaces.
Yes. And you know, and it's always as though I cannot be a great leader in the same space with other great leaders.
That's correct. And which actually leads me to another question I have. Should leaders hold on to grudges or shame other leaders?
Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no. Grudges, all of that's negative. Great leaders, in my humble opinion, should not hold on to anything negative. Anything that is will destroy the spirit of someone, destroy that person physically or mentally, their mind, body, or soul, anything that will do that, any emotion, action, or anything that is negative, that is not a great leader. That is not a great leader. Because a great leader is all about building, elevating, empowering, inspiring. These are all love, compassion. All of these are positive emotions and positive actions. And if you are not being an example of this, you're not a great leader.
Yeah, because, you know, Denise right here, she's saying great leaders know when to follow. And I think that's one of the, you know, that is a good concept. They had that concept around way before I was born. But I also believe from the movements I've been on, because I'm not just speaking, you know, hot breath, right? You know, I'm actually been a part inside, been a part of these structures, been a part of many different movements. And leaders that run into other leaders that are willing to follow them, a lot of times want to put them and keep them in the following role. They don't want to move them out from being followers. And you have to be very, very aware of who you're following and why you may be following these different leaders. Because if these leaders are not here to bring substance to your life and to the lives of those that are around you, for you can increase your inner circle as well as your outer circle, then those leaders you have to flee from, like you're running from a pack of wolves.
Yeah.
Right? You need to understand what's really happening to you as a leader, how you're being used and dictated as a leader, and how you're being evaluated as a leader. The leader that believes that he's great above other leaders has lost his sense of greatness.
Yes. Yes. And we had spoke about this earlier before the show, Nathaniel, about cultivating others, younger people. I always love to, you know, focus on the younger people, because when I am gone from this earth, I want to know that it's in good hands. I want to know that there is someone that I have influenced enough to keep spreading the love, keep spreading the joy and the happiness that I have found. And that means empowering others.
Yeah, because if you, all right, so for instance, I go into the Bible and I pull out Christ, right, for an example. You go into the Quran and you pull out Muhammad, for an example, right? Both of these men found other men and women that had a purpose within them that they was able to see and brought them to the forefront. Even if you go throughout the Bible, Christ always instructed the apostles how to become stronger. He always let them know, oh, come on, man. You know what I mean? You weak, man. You have little faith. Build your faith up, man. You know what I'm saying? Increase yourself from within, man. What's going on with you? You could do the same thing I did, man. That's why you here with me, because you do the same thing that I did. I did not come here to take away your power, nor did I come here to change the course of time. I came here to bring life, you know what I'm saying, to the forefront. And if leaders are not taking on this type of doctrine, right, they are doing a disservice to other leaders. And they believe that they have done nothing wrong by not increasing the leadership that have come into their midst. You know what I'm saying? They would tell you, y'all, you know, I'm a leader. I got where I got to go. And they'd be like, yo, I need you to go. You should go get a job, man, so you can take care of you and your family.
Yes.
Right? Oh, yes. If I wanted a job, I wouldn't have been on this platform. I'd have been doing something else.
Yes.
Right? If that's what I really wanted, I'd have been doing something else. You know what I mean? So I believe, as far as even a lot of my friends, you know, when they would actually lose hope, you know what I mean, in life, I'd be like, nah, man, we got to keep pushing, bro. You know, we got to keep pushing. I said, didn't we survive the thing last week? They'd be like, yeah. I said, you know, So we need to keep pushing. We need to understand, you know, what we went through. We need to understand our stripes, you know, our beatings, you know. Yes. We need to understand what our punishments are, you know, to move us out of a certain space, because the Most High said, I chastise those that I love.
Right? That's right. That's right. And that is being grateful for that. See, I heard a speaker once said, be thankful when God does show you that he is displeased with something.
That's right. Be grateful. Thankful for that. Because he doesn't see, and that's what it is, the mercy. The Most High says, I repent. I'm full of, why would the Most High repent? Right? The Most High is supposed to be, you know, he's supposed to, you know, be everlasting, right? He's not supposed to be without sin, right? He's not supposed to be about the emotions that man determines. But you can see in the scripture, the Most High said, I repent for this. I repent for this. I repent for that. Right. Why? Right? Because even the Most High sees that he may make a decision in the moment that he has to come back and reevaluate.
That's right.
What makes you think that man is not going to afford to come back to the situation to reevaluate? Who are you to make you think that you have a greater power than the Most High? That he can repent, but you cannot repent. That he can show mercy, but you cannot show mercy. That he can show gratitude, but you choose not to show gratitude. Who are you?
That's the arrogance. That's the arrogance that we encounter in this world. That's the arrogance. And that's why humility is so important.
Humility is so important. It's so important. You know, do you believe that all leaders know that they are leaders?
No. No, all leaders
do not. There you go. There you go. And that leaves room for cultivation. When you know that all leaders don't have every tool and resource they need to be a leader, that gives you a position to cultivate, to increase, and to empower. And if you choose not to do so, that means that any situation that you go into, you need to have all your ducks lined up in a row. Because you expect others to have that. So you should always have that.
And that's seeing the potential in others, Nathaniel. That's sometimes looking past where a person may be at the moment and seeing into having insight. And that's why it's important as a leader to build up that insight, to work on being insightful about other people. And that takes being unselfish and not always focusing on me.
And you got to move yourself out the equation.
Yes. And seeing the potential in others.
Seeing the potential. Yeah, because you are water. You know, you're water to the seeds that come to you.
Right.
Right. Because you've already been watered. So don't expect everybody to come to you to be watered. You know, you have to start watering.
Yes.
Because you already got your substance. That's why you're here. Right? Don't come in the room and try to take other gifts and take other purposes as if they belong to you. They don't belong to you.
Right.
You here to water these things and cultivate these things. I want to make sure that we stay within an hour so, you know, everything can run smooth with us posting and stuff like that. So I want to do a last question, and then we're going to go into the last part with the meditation. Right?
Okay.
The last question is leadership a one-man show and tell?
Oh, no. Oh, no. And when we think that we are that, we are no longer effective leaders when we think it's all about me.
See, that's what it comes down to. Effective leaders, right? I ran across this leader one time. He's been doing a lot of different things, dealing with, you know, reentry movements and stuff like that. He's working with judges and lawyers and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. And I asked him one day, I seen him, I said, yeah, brother, you know, what are you up to? He said, yeah, you know, I've been having some meetings, you know, with these lawmakers and these, you know, government officials and stuff like that. And, you know, they'd be giving me $50,000 for me to, to let them know, you know, the ins and outs of incarceration, of how you felt when you was inside, how you felt when you was outside, and create these different models. And I asked him a question. Are you at these meetings by yourself? And he said, yes. And I said, this is a disservice to other leaders that walked in the same platform that you walked
on. Yes.
Right? Why would you bring other men and women there to get $50,000? They don't want to work for nobody either. We've been working in prison for 60 cents, for 6 cents an hour. Why you want to come home and get on movements and still work for these different plantational structures that is not giving us the substance that we need for our families and for our lives? We just came from working for 6 cents, 60 cents, $1.25 an hour. No one want to do those things. Your $20 an hour also equates to 6 cents an hour. According to the economic structure of this time right here.
Wow.
But you will not bring other leaders to the table so they can also eat from these entities that's eating off of you and off of our experiences. Not just your experience, but our experiences. Because we walked through this path the same as you. And how do you know that? Because you saw us on the same platform as you. So you know we walked on the same platform that you walked on. We walked through the same corridors. I was locked up in a box just like you. You know what I'm saying? I had to eat that nasty food in the mess hall just like you. You know what I'm saying? I had to go sit in mandatory classes, you know what I'm saying, to learn rubbish just like you. You know what I'm saying? What makes you think that you're able to have opportunities, you know what I'm saying, that we cannot have so we can increase ourselves and our brothers and sisters so they will not perpetuate the same things that we have?
Yes. 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 That's right. That's right, Nathaniel. That
don't
is
go
so...
in these spaces and rob these spaces for sources and tools that you will not share with your brothers and sisters, and then turn around and judge your brothers and sisters as they fall one by one. Because they are going to fall. I don't care what you say. Oh, these leaders don't fall. You better look back in history. You better go read some history books.
Yes.
You better go read some more. Go to Barnes & Noble. They open right now and buy every book on history, and I bet you, you will be confounded.
About the fall. The fall.
The fall of leaders and how they fell and who came into their midst to cause them a fall. Who took tricks and who took gifts to bring other leaders out of the equations. You will be surprised.
Yes. Yes.
And with that, I want the sister to put on that vibration and bring us into a meditative state for 1 minute, and then we're going to sound off. And we're going to see y'all guys next week again on Sunday at the same time with a whole nother explosive topic. It's all on you now, sister.
Okay, here we go. Can you hear that?
Yes.
Okay. Close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Take a deep breath. Starting with your head, relax. Relax your neck. Take a deep breath. Let it out slow. We're moving on down our body into our arms. Relax your arms. Take a deep breath. Let it out slow. Move on down into your legs. Relax the muscles in your legs. Take a deep breath and let it out slow. We are going to count to five backwards. And when we reach the number one, we're going to open our eyes slowly and take another deep breath and let it out slow. Five, four, three, two, one. Open your eyes slowly. Take a deep breath and let it out slowly.
Thank Many you. People don't know this.
Awesome. And with that, guys, blessings. Have a great day. Focus on your leadership. Focus on your gratitude. Focus on your purpose. And focus on your growth as an individual. So when you have, when you come into these spaces, you have the strength, I'm saying, withstand all things that come against you and then lock in your purpose. With that, deuces. Good day, guys.
Peace and blessings.
Peace and blessings.